Square root of 2 has geometric significance as a result of Pythagorean theorem, and algebraic significance as it is one of the first numbers proved to be irrational. Maybe you have gone to the calculator and it outputs the value of square root of 2, but how does the calculator do this? You might think that they have some storage so that whenever someone asks for these inputs, they immediately spew out the digits you see on the screen. But most likely, there is no such storage. There are just too many possible inputs. Here are three ways from the least to most efficient to calculate any square roots in general. The first is long division. It works like this. First, add a decimal point and many zeros behind the number. Then add the square root sign and slice the number at the decimal point. Slice every two zeros behind the decimal point, and if there are more than two digits before the decimal point, also slice them every two digits from the decimal point. For the leftmost slice, write down the number whose square is just smaller than this number. Subtract this number squared, then add the two digits behind. Multiply the quotient by 2 and write it down on the left. Write also a blank. This blank must be the same as the one you are going to put next. Fill in this blank so that this product is just under the remainder. With the two digits in the quotient, multiply these two digits together by 2 and put it on the left side. Repeat what you have done. It is a really good method if you only want a few digits, but in the long run, it is the least efficient. Secondly, we have continued fraction. Note that only some square roots can be more efficiently calculated this way. This is because there is no general method to write down the continued fraction of a square root. Continued fraction looks complicated like this, but we often simplify it with this notation. If we denote alpha as the infinite continued fraction, then by truncating it at different layers, we have these different fractions, which gets closer and closer to alpha. We also denote the truncated continued fraction at the nth layer to be Pn over Qn. Continued fraction has an interesting property shown on the screen. Although it looks complicated, don't worry, because I will use an example to illustrate that. Now let's use square root of 3 as an example. We know that it is between 1 and 2. So the integral part of square root of 3 is 1, and the yellow part is the remaining part. Take the reciprocal, rationalize the fraction, and we get square root of 3 plus 1 divided by 2. Now from the original inequality, we get this new inequality with square root of 3 plus 1 divided by 2. So the integral part here is 1 again. Now take the reciprocal, rationalize the fraction, and we get square root of 3 plus 1. From this inequality, we get square root of 3 plus 1 is between 2 and 3, so the integral part here is 2. But the remaining part, square root of 3 minus 1, is something similar, because it is the entire fractional part we start off with. So we can then repeat and get the same integral parts. So we can now write square root of 3 in terms of continued fraction as shown. Or if you want to be cool, write a bar above 1, 2 to denote that from then on it would be 1 and 2 alternately. Now you can imagine that this is not efficient for some other square roots. It might already take a lot of work to get the continued fraction, and we still have not approximated the square roots yet. So this method is only more efficient for some square roots. Now back to the approximation of square root of 3. We have this continued fraction expression here. Then this sequence of numbers get closer and closer to the square root. We know the value of the first few pretty easily, but the further down the sequence, the harder it gets. This is where the property comes in handy. We only need to know the previous two fractions, as well as the last entry of the continued fraction. So, we can use this property to get the fraction to be 7 over 4 without having to calculate the entire continued fraction again. For the next fraction, the previous two fractions would be shifted, while the last entry now becomes 2. Now we can apply the property and we can get 19 over 11 pretty easily. If you want better approximations, you could use this property a few more times. The third method is Babylonian method. To approximate the square root of a, firstly we take a guess a0, which can be anything positive, but practically it should not differ from square root of a too much. Then we take the average of the previous value and a over the previous value. Let's say we want to approximate the square root of 5. Then we first take a reasonable guess of 2, then take the average of 2 and 5 over 2 to get 9 over 4. Then take the average of 9 over 4 and 5 over 9 over 4 to get a2. If you start off with 2, then only after 3 iterations, you will have 10 correct digits of square root of 5, so this is a very efficient method. Next video is going to be about why these methods work. Subscribe if you want more of these math videos. See you next time!